And now from our studios in downtown Winnipeg, it's time for 107 Live.
This Tuesday, the 11th of February at 2 p.m., the Music and Mavens Concert and Lecture Series welcomes the Lavallée Buzash Duo in a program of music of Mozart, Piazzolla, Carlos Gardel, and others. The Lavallée Buzash Duo consists of Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra's Assistant Principal Violist, Élise Lavallée, and the Winnipeg Symphony Orchestra's Second Violin, Principal Second Violin, Jeremy Buzash. Joining me here in the Classic 107 studios are Élise Lavallée and Jeremy Buzash. Welcome to our Classic 107 studios. It's so great to have you here.
Thank you. Hi.
So, first of all, tell us what you just performed.
So, we just played Pour una cabeza, a very, very famous tango by Carlos Gardel.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, it's just a beautiful, beautiful place. So first thing I want to get to is February has been extremely busy for the both of you between Winnipeg New Music Festival just wrapping up last week, and then you've got the Scandinavian Greats concert that's happening this weekend with the WSO, and then this concert coming up on Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
When do you sleep? Is it just practice and Red Bull?
We're still recovering.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, after the New Music Festival, we always have 4 days off. Like, it's in the books. We need to have 4 days off after. So you spend 2 days, like, relaxing. I went to the spa, and then after that, it's like, oops,
I need to
get back into it because it just keeps going.
And for listeners out there who don't know, the New Music Festival, it's not like you're getting the parts 6 months in advance. Some of the music's coming like very short notice, mm-hmm. right?
Yes,
and some of it is not easy. So there's a lot of pressure to, get on top of it and take care of business. So it's an incredibly intense situation for the WSO, and it's amazing. My first question when it comes to the duo is, how did you two get connected and how did the duo start? You want to talk us through that? How the two of you met, like, decided to form the Lavallée Buzash Duo?
Well, I think you just asked me.
I heard him play in audition, when he auditioned for the symphony, you know, the audition process.
Yeah.
And I was there. I was on the committee, the jury. And I just came out and I said, you sound amazing. He played Bach Chaconne for his audition. I mean,
the D minor.
With other things as well, but that. And I was just like, wow. So then I said, I just want to play with you, you know? And he's like, okay. So this is how it started.
That's it. Yeah. A beautiful thing was born. That's amazing.
It's been fun. We've done some good concerts. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you're doing the concert on Tuesday as part of the Music and Mavens concert and lecture series. Did you approach them about the concert, or how did that work? Did they approach you?
I think it was through Carla. We just had an opportunity to play, and she liked the repertoire that we were proposing.
All right. Mm-hmm. So it's that simple. And speaking of repertoire, the concert on Tuesday, it's has a lot of variety. You're doing the Halvorsen arrangement of the music of Handel. Mm-hmm. You're doing a Mozart duo, but a lot of music by Argentinian composers, right? Mm-hmm. Why Argentinian composers? What was the draw?
Well, I think just in general, tangos are really fun to play. And Elise had bought this collection of arrangements for violin and viola. And they were fun and good. And we like to perform them in serious concerts because there's a lot of great music there.
Yeah, it's, you know, and music from Argentina is so amazing. And there's so many amazing musicians that came out of there. Mm-hmm. It's incredible.
I feel like it's a good balance also to the, mm-hmm. you know, the Mozart. Yeah. I mean, there are two duos,
right.
But when you play both, I don't know if you can have too much Mozart, but it's a lot of Mozart.
Yeah.
So we decided to just do one. And then with the tango, it's a little bit of the same because it's a duo. It's a little bit of the same, you know, exchange response right. to one another like this. So I think it flows really nicely.
Oh, that's great. I have to ask, I've played music of Piazzolla, and one of the things that I find with Piazzolla is he'll very often like put in grace notes or some kind of trills, or and the whole purpose of those is to make the music sound improvisatory. Mm-hmm. Does he do that in the music that you're playing?
The other question is,
are any of the other Argentinian composers writing their music the same way? Like, do you come across that situation?
What can I answer first?
Yeah, okay. Of course, yeah.
So we're going to play Oblivion, super famous Piazzolla tango. And I don't know how they got this on paper. It's exactly what you're saying. How do you put improvisation on paper for string players? Because we're not improvising. And the rhythms are super complicated because it's supposed to sound like it's flowing.
Like it's coming
out of
you,
really difficult to play that. Like it's just, that's one of the difficult things for me in this Oblivion for sure. We have another piece that we really like by Carlos Gardel, El Dia Que Me Quieras. To answer your question, that's not at all, that's actually a chanson, a song.
Yeah.
Oui. And it's free, but it's nothing like Piazzolla.
Ah.
And a lot of these tangos are really, they're grounded in terms of having a rhythm below the melody.
Right.
So the melody is kind of free to, you know, wave and, you know, pull and push over these mm-hmm. these grounded rhythms
that
are happening.
I saw an interview with Piazzolla on YouTube. You can find anything on YouTube. And one of the things that he's encouraging his musicians to sort of improvise, like mm-hmm. take the melody and don't just play it straight, mm-hmm. do something with it, you know, whether grace notes or glisses.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And if you were reading along in the Gardel, like my part hardly matched to it. I was changing rhythms all over the place and, you know, you just do in the moment what feels right.
Yeah, he always says we have to feel like we're dancing,
that's
you know,
right.
So it's more of a...
And one of the things about the tango is it's all about the dancers, right? Mm-hmm. It's sort of like the musicians are reacting to what, you know, the dancers are doing. And so there's this give and take you know, between the two. One of the things I always find fascinating listening to string duos is this idea of double stops.
Mm.
Because, I mean, it's not like we've got just the two voices going on. You can have, with double stops, it can sound like there's four individual lines or mm-hmm. sometimes even five individual lines. First of all, for our listeners out there who don't know, what is a double stop? Can you just briefly talk us through that?
Yeah, well, it's basically playing two different notes at the same time. And string instruments are capable of playing triple stops or quadruple stops.
So two strings or three strings.
Yeah, exactly.
Or four strings.
Yeah.
At the same time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean,
so the two of us could play 8 notes.
Right.
Yeah.
So you'd be basically bowing multiple strings at the same time. And then it leads, sort of leads me to the other question, tuning. It's so, like, I'm always amazed. I know string players will spend hours and hours a day practicing scales, in double stops. How does it work when you have the two players together? You know what I'm asking? Like, if one note is just a little bit out, how do you make up for that?
You're like...
it's just a matter of just rehearsal.
I think that, and
ears.
Yeah, but we both know and hear what key we're in. Right. I mean, we don't know necessarily intellectually, but so especially,
and a lot of,
like,
it is context too.
Yeah, the Handel-Halvorsen has,
right. This is a piece I'm thinking
big
of.
Big piece, meaty. Yeah. With,
are you doing the Passacaglia?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. So it sounds like. Yeah, it's pretty wild. So I think, I mean, in this sense, because I play the lower voice most of the time, I'm kind of, the bass for his notes. So I guess you have to adjust to me, don't you?
I don't know. So
we just play.
Yeah, and there's that whole other thing, singers do this too, where you're playing, the T moving to the Do, right? Are you playing if the 7 needs to go, like, so there's, you might play one note a little sharper than it needs to be in order to resolve.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, we don't play like a piano.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're not equal temperament, so we can really, we can make different colors by playing certain notes sharp or more flat to kind of fit in with a keyboard.
Right, and sort of really blend.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's amazing. So you're doing the Halvorsen Passacaglia. Can you talk about that? It's such a fantastic piece.
Yeah, it's commonly done with violin and cello as well.
Right.
But violin viol is also a very great arrangement.
And my understanding, I think, is that essentially what Halvorsen did was he took a set of keyboard variations by Handel and arranged those variations for just violin and viola, right?
Yeah.
And there, like you say, there are tons of double stops in both parts,
right?
Yeah,
it's very virtuosic.
Yeah, it's really show off. So we start with a pretty simple theme. So this piece is really easy listening because you always, it's kind of repeats, harmonically and stuff. But with spiccato, with pizzas, with running scales, with different colors, different moods, it's quite demanding.
Yeah.
On the viola too, the viola responds a little bit slower than the violin, and you have to match in this piece. So it's a show off piece.
Yeah.
It's
for the duo.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And you're doing one of the Mozart duos on the program on Tuesday. He wrote two of them, right? Both of them in 1783. What is it about this one that drew you to it? Why did you pick this one out of the edit?
I think we were just both more familiar with it, and that's why we chose it. We've played number two as well, but it's much more difficult, I think.
Huh.
Yeah.
I was doing some reading about those duos, and apparently what he did was he did it to fulfill some kind of a commission that Michael Haydn had done for duos. Mm.
Yes,
and
yes. He was sort of helping out.
Just fill it out. Is it like, obviously it's Mozart, but what's it like for the two instruments? How is the writing? I just find with Mozart, he can write for anything and make it sound amazing.
Yeah, well, he was a great string player.
Yeah.
So
he loved the viola.
Yeah.
So, with his symphony concertante also, and the duos, he really brings the viola to the same level as the violin, as a voice and not just an accompaniment. I mean, it's super well written. The first movement is really fun, a little bit, again, show-off acrobatic. The second movement is just gorgeous, really peaceful, and a little rondo at the end with variations again.
Right.
So, it's a really fun, it's a fun concert. Some things are challenging, but it's also really fun for us to play together and...
It just sounds like an amazing concert. Like, it's such a great contrast between the Halvorsen, the Mozart, and then all the tango. Jeremy and Elise, I just want to thank you so much for stopping by our Classic 107 studios and talking to us today. It's been just an absolute treat. Join the Lavallée Buzash Duo this Tuesday at 2 p.m. at the Rady Jewish Community Center located at 123 Doncaster Street. This concert that they are putting on for the Music and Mavens Concert and Lecture Series is going to be just great. If you want more information, you can go to radyjcc.com and just click on the link at the bottom of the homepage. Thanks once again for stopping by. It's just been wonderful.
From our studios in downtown Winnipeg, you've been listening to 107 Live, Classic 107's Intimate Concert Series, the soundtrack for your life.